I first met Moctesuma about 6 months ago. I was actually recruiting him for an advisory board position for my company, which he thankfully for me agreed to do. And I've gotten to know him a little bit over about four meetings. And he immediately struck me as someone who is perfect for this kind of thing. Very accomplished, very humble, and you can just tell by spending time with him that he's a person that lives independently, gets what he wants in a very positive way, and also is just seems to be a contented person overall, which I think is the key to life, right? And so a little bit of his background, and I'm going to let Moctesuma talk for about 10 minutes about his background and his perspectives on the subject. Then I'm going to interview Moctesuma for about 25 minutes, and then we'll have a good 25 minutes. But a little bit about Moctesuma, and we'll talk. But he was born here in East Los Angeles, California. Father was from Mexico around 1918, I believe, right around the time of the Mexican Revolution. So clearly, an overall view on life. Moctesuma went on to attend UCLA, where he studied film. As an undergrad, he ended up getting an MFA in film. And a pivotal moment in Moctesuma's life was in 1968, I think it was March 1968, was a walkout. And it started off as a form of protest by Mexican-Americans or Hispanic-American in general on the treatment in the education system. And from my reading of the situation, I read articles, and what you read in the press is not always accurate, so I'll need some touching up. But you were sort of the media liaison, which ended up giving a higher profile. And the end result was, I think 20,000 students did not go to school for a week. So it was a pretty significant movement. So Moctesuma ended up working for PBS, doing a lot of production for them. Ended up getting into film production, some incredible films like Selena, Milagro Beanfield War, which was Robert Redford was behind that as well with him. And also a lot of recent films. The one that the Dry Land is a recent movie that Moctesuma put together through Maya Cinemas, which is an individual who comes back from Iraq dealing with post-traumatic stress syndrome. So that recently won Best Film at Houston Film Festival, and it's nominated for the Grand Jury Prize at Sundance. So Moctesuma is he's an entrepreneur. He's a philanthropist, an activist, and also a film producer. Very eclectic life, and very happy to have him with us. And if you'd be so kind to tell everyone a little bit about your background, and we can take it from there.
Well, it's wonderful being here with you. When I told my wife that I'd been asked to come give a talk on quality of life, she laughed. And she said, what are you going to tell them? So she said, make something up. I'm sure you'll figure out something to say. So I'm going to endeavor not to make things up, but I sympathize with my wife laughing, since she knows me the best after we've been married now for 33 years. And I'm going to talk about that. I hadn't anticipated that I would start off talking about my marriage. And as I reflect on it, I think that a great deal of my peace that I feel in my life today comes out of how I've related to my wife and my marriage. And over the 33 years that we have been married, we had a lot of issues and problems. And our children, we have four children. My daughter gave me and my wife immense amount of, when she was young, when she became a teenager, I thought she got possessed. And, she didn't return human being until about 20. And now, she's making sure that I know every moment of the time how I'm going to do better. It works for me, supposedly. But I think I work for her. I think of it is that I've, at some moment in my marriage, I accepted that I was not going to be able to change my wife. And she wasn't going to be what I wanted. And I accepted that she is who she is. And when that happened, and it was really a challenge, because I really thought she could be better, you know, she changed. And needless to say, she hasn't quite given up changing me. But that moment where I accepted, this is who I'm married to, and I have two choices. I can accept this marriage and embrace it and be in the love that I have for my wife, or I can continue to feel miserable and unhappy about how nothing's working in my marriage. And when I accepted my marriage, I felt immense peace. And all of a sudden, how we related to each other changed. And how she related to me changed. And she stopped fearing that I was going to leave her. And I stopped thinking about leaving her. And that became the keystone for how I've now approached the rest of my life, which is accepting what is. And so accepting what is very different than being content and allowing those things in my life that I desire to transform to not be things that I strive for. It's very different. Accepting what is not fighting the moment, not fighting the reality of what I'm living at the moment. Because if I resist what's real, what's in the moment, then I'm actually resisting my life. And if I'm resisting my life, then I'm not accepting myself, and I'm not accepting the way that I am, and the way things are, for better or for worse. And I have aspirations and hopes and desires for how I can transform myself and transform my life. And I apply my will and my actions to those ends. And I view them as intentions for what I am seeking to have happen in my life. While at the same time, I accept the reality of the moment that I have. I don't know if I've been effective in communicating that. And what I intend for you to get is that how I relate to my life in terms of those things that I seek to transform, in terms of my actions, in terms of what I do in life, continues. I have the same emotional passion for transforming life, for social justice, for storytelling, for being of service, that I had when I was 15 or 18 or 20 or 30. What I'm no longer subjecting myself to is the stress and unhappiness of rejecting the moment that I'm in. And so, disappointments and failures and things that don't work out, I accept in the same way that I accept successes, achievements, and those things that do work out. They're what's real in the moment for me. there's a lot of peace there. What that looks like is that I have worked at having my emotions be my choice. While at the same time, I experience and accept the emotions that I have. So if I'm in a spot where something didn't work out the way I had intended, and I have a flash of either anger, disappointment, sadness, I feel it in that moment. And then I choose a new emotion. And then I choose what I'm going to do next. And I let go of the emotions that are in the way of me being who I intend to be. And the only way that I can do that is by owning the emotion and letting it go. And choosing a new one. As a consequence of that, my happiness is not dependent on the world. My happiness and contentment is my choice. No matter what's going on in the world.
Thanks for that. Are there any things that you do, any practices that you do in your life that help position you for that sort of disposition of being in tune with your emotions and along those lines that allow you to recognize your emotional weather, decide what deserves a chair at the table, etc.?
I had an extraordinary teacher by the name of Fernando Flores. And it is what I learned from Fernando that I practice every day and every moment, which is to listen to myself. By listening to what I say, to what I'm thinking, in an active way, engage, actually listening to what I say, I discover who it is that I am and what it is that I'm feeling, consciously. So that's the discipline that I follow.
And as far as, like you're saying, being in control of your emotions and along those lines, a lot of people think of the thoughts that come out of their mind as sort of, that's your mind and that's your, that it's a central part of who you are. I mean, what's your philosophy on sort of those thoughts? Is it just a lot more junior position than most people think in terms of thoughts that get generated? I mean, I think a lot of people can maybe give them more credit than they deserve in terms of who they are.
Well, Fernando displayed to me that I didn't know how to think, and that what I passed off as thinking was actually being a slave to the subconscious programming that I had accepted from my world, which included my family, my culture, my upbringing, all of the beliefs that operated in the background that were running my behavior, that were running my thoughts, were actually unexamined beliefs. That I wasn't really the author. It's the subconscious, in my experience, and from what I've learned, is a dumb computer that regurgitates what we've allowed to be programmed into it, consciously or unconsciously. And so that's where the discipline of listening to myself becomes the powerful tool of being able to own my own life. So as I listen to myself, I'm then able to judge if I actually want to own and believe what I'm saying or what I'm thinking, and if it actually represents who I intend to be. And what I've found over the 25 years of this discipline is that most of the stuff that I thought was unconscious regurgitation of beliefs that I accepted that were not at all what I intended to be or who I intended to be in the world. They were a whole series of second-guessing, recriminations, why didn't I do this, why did that person do that, how come I didn't do this in this situation, that's unfair, that's unjust. Just a whole bunch of judgments that had no real utility in moving my life forward. And so as I listened to them, I was then able to have that thing shut up.
And that habit of listening to yourself, has that also led to you, did that also lead to you being more conscious of not just your own thoughts, but the world around you?
Yes.
Nature, beauty, things like that?
Yeah, it concentrates me, and it brings me to the present.
Interesting. And that last point you mentioned about not being as judgmental and having those types of thoughts. What's your take on that? I mean, do you find that you're pretty good at giving people the benefit of the doubt?
I take people at their word.
You assume.
Most people don't listen to each other. So what I've learned is that what people say is actually what they mean. And listening to them is also a discipline. Listening to other people is an extraordinary thing when it's done consciously.
Can you talk a little bit more about how listening skills can manifest themselves to quality of life?
Well, when you are listening to someone, there's no other thought going on in your brain. The moment that another thought pops up and you're beginning to judge what the person is saying, you're no longer listening. So again, that is a discipline that concentrates me and brings me to the moment. And being in the moment is remarkably peaceful.
Part of enjoying life is, I guess, from something I've noticed from people that I've interviewed is that you'll see with certain people that people tend to want to do them good, do them right. And I wonder if that listening skills, I mean, I'm sure it's something that you're not, don't think about, but I wonder if that contributes that to a little bit, where people feel like, wow, he's really listening, it kind of makes people want to support what you're trying to achieve and attain.
My responsibility is to actually own the outcome of other people listening to me. So I take responsibility for someone actually hearing what I intend. If someone didn't hear what I intended, I consider it my failure, not theirs.
And what about, besides day-to-day interactions, when you're dealing with high-stakes situations, you know, a pivotal conversation or some meeting of consequence, let's say, do you have any habits around that of spending time on what you want to communicate, and have you found that to be useful?
Well, yes.
Is that something that you did?
I enter every moment with an intention.
Just a big picture question. I mean, what are what are some things that need to be happening in your life for you to feel great?
Sleep. I've got to get some sleep. Without sleep, my life doesn't work.
How much sleep do you need?
7 hours.
Do you usually go to bed around the same time?
Yes.
You're not traveling?
10:30, 11 o'clock. I go to sleep.
What other things? Exercise? Do you have any other
I go to the gym Monday through Friday. I run 2 miles every morning. Do yoga at least once a week and maintain a disciplined diet.
Tell us about your diet a little
bit.
Only meat?
I eat very little fish, very little chicken and turkey, but I'd say about 90% of my diet is vegetarian. And my breakfast is a glass of freshly squeezed green juice with some bee pollen and some flax seeds. that's my breakfast.
What vegetables go into it?
Celery, cucumber, green apple, parsley, spinach.
You have a juicer?
A champion juicer, yes.
You recommend it?
It works. It works. My wife does the juicing. I'm very thankful for her. I read a book recently that confirmed my habits called The China Study. It was on the New York bestseller list for a long time. And it's a study of health conditions and habits and nutrition in the country of China, and then extrapolates and brings in studies from the rest of the world. And it basically shares with the reader that there are two kinds of illnesses in the world. There are illnesses of affluence and illnesses of poverty. And the illnesses of affluence are degenerative diseases. They're diabetes, high blood pressure, heart disease, multiple sclerosis, cancer. And then there are the diseases of poverty are lung diseases, digestive diseases, consumption. And very clearly you see those in the world. And all of the studies pointed to that. The other thing the book found was that as soon as you have more than 5% animal protein in your diet, that the incidence of Western diseases of affluence increases very sharply.
China study, huh?
Yep.
To write that down.
What about the issue of getting what you want, right? I mean, it's something that should not have a negative connotation in life. Seeing things that you want to get and going out and achieving them. Are there any things that you do in your life that help you on that front? If I was to let's say, shadow you for a couple days while you're on vacation and you're trying to get a hotel room, the best hotel room or table at a restaurant, what are some things I might observe watching in those kinds of situations?
I conduct myself the same when I'm working or on vacation. So I don't know that you would see anything different.
How do you get what you want?
I request it.
It is that simple, huh?
Yes.
And how do you, what's your style?
I ask directly.
So you're very direct in all your communication.
I find that works. Now, in some cultures it doesn't work, but in the United States it does. People appreciate directness. So in this culture, it works, and happily I'm in this culture, so that's what I do.
What?
And then I either get it or I don't get it. accept that I didn't get it, and I request something else.
On the issue of productivity and getting things done, I mean, you're obviously an incredibly accomplished person. I doubt that happens without planning and being a productive person with your time. Anything you do on kind of time productivity or, you know, how you deal with tasks that you could share?
I do focus and create a list of things that I intend to get done. And I work on things with precision and focus one by one. I think that the single most important trait that I've developed, or capacity that I've developed, is to move from one item to another completely. So when I'm doing X, I'm not still doing Y. I stopped doing Y. I'm now doing X. And when I move to W, I'm doing W, not X. So it's the ability to be with what I'm doing when I'm doing it that allows me to achieve a great deal.
Mm-hmm. And when we met last week, you said that your email box, you don't let that get out of that.
No, I clear that every day. I usually get 100, 150 emails a day, and I clear them as I go through the day.
Is that something you'd suggest to someone in terms of looking to be more productive and effective on that? Just not letting the email box get beyond a certain number?
Well, I find that if I don't clear my email, where I didn't. What I intend doesn't occur. What I'm looking to achieve slips through a moment. And I'm not achieving what my intentions are. I'm not as productive. I'm not staying in communication with the people that I intend to stay in communication with. So email has, to a certain extent, replaced correspondence, and it's replaced even the telephone. So since that is the way that I find that the people that I work with communicate, it is vital that I be present to the fact that I have a communication, I have a conversation with someone, and the way that conversation is continued or concluded or resolved is by being attentive to the conversation, and that means being attentive to my.
Kind of big picture, I mean, you're obviously a very rational, logical thinker. Do you also let some things slip and, you know, sort of the dichotomy of, having your principles and your ideas and all that, and then sometimes letting things slip or, behave differently than your main way of doing it? Enjoying that in a way.
Yeah, I'm human. So yes, I fail. Things don't get done. Things don't get achieved the way I intend them to. And it is that discipline of listening to myself that allows me then to discover why I failed, how I failed, so that I can then choose a new course.
One area I'd like to ask you about is humility. You seem like someone that doesn't treat someone of quote-unquote high station, someone across the spectrum, that you seem to treat everyone the same, as long as, same level of integrity and such. But on that issue of humility and treating others with respect, could you share your perspectives on that subject and how you think that affects one's quality of life, depending on how, to what degree they do treat others with respect?
My father, as a little boy, shared with me that everyone is the same. And that he and I should treat royalty, he actually referred to royalty or a laborer, with the same respect and dignity, as they were ultimately the same. And that one role in life is, has no more dignity than another. That all roles in life, lived consciously, have the same possibility of fulfillment and dignity as any other. So it's my father's example that I follow. Now, I was actually, as a child, very, very shy. And I still feel some of that. He would obligate me, force me to talk to people, and take me out and go out together. I only saw him really one day a week. And so that one day a week, which was Monday when he didn't work, we would go out. And he'd take me to Clifton's cafeteria downtown, take me to the $1 million theater, we'd see a movie, then we'd go to the States, see another movie, have dinner at Clifton's, and he'd talk to the hostesses and to the servers, and he'd make me talk to them. I was terrified, I was mortified. I just did not want to be in public or talk to anyone. And he obligated me to do it. And he was someone who was really charming, and people loved to be around. So that example is still an example that I'm striving to be who I am today. And, my father worked harder and longer than anyone I know. And so I'm still striving to achieve what he achieved. And he had that peace in his life. And so it's that that guides me, the understanding that there is no difference in any of us.
What's interesting is that, you know, when you think about that issue of treating others with respect, I think everyone sort of thinks about, you know, people that maybe can do less for them than vice versa. And the way you put it was, it goes both ways, but it also means, you know, someone that, let's say royalty, that you also learn that they also are no different than you. So I imagine that was a kind of a big boost to your overall confidence entering the world and not feeling, you know, intimidated and talking with people of all different levels of organizations, it would seem.
Yep, it's gotten me into a lot of trouble.
On that issue of, where you started talking a little bit about parenting, and you being the child in that case, getting back to the issue of parenting, you know, I've got three young kids, and if I was to force you to give me some advice on that area, you know, what are one or two things on the parenting front that you think work?
What's very clear to me, and which I also learned from my father, is that we do not own our children. They are not here for us. We're here for them.
And they're not here to embody our
aspirations or goals or desires, or to live our life, or for us to live our life through them.
You think that some of your children have really appreciated from you that you
they're all their own individuals, they're all their own persons, and they definitely don't agree with me with a great deal.
Wonderful. Well, let's open it up to questions. Go ahead and Moctesuma, I'll let you sort of moderate and pick questions.
Certainly.
Hi, my name is Karen. I had you had said that you appreciated people that were really direct and upfront and straightforward with you, so I have a couple questions. One, I wanted to know about your daughter. I heard when you were saying that you thought she was possessed, everybody kind of chuckled. And for me, I felt somewhat of a pang because I was kind of like your daughter, never really thought I was possessed. But I'm wondering, now that you have accepted reality, do you feel that you've accepted her path at that point in time before she turned 21? How do you feel about that now?
It was a remarkably painful experience for our entire family. She ran away from home and did everything that would mortify any parent that you can imagine. And I actually had to bring the police in and have her arrested to save her from herself. It was the most painful part of my life. And my inability to be of service to her then is the one failure of my life. So what I did was the only thing that I thought that I could do, which was to at least put her in a place, in a situation where she wouldn't harm herself. Yes.
Is it possible for you to think that maybe at that juncture in time, or at everybody's juncture, at any point in time in anybody's life, any given point, everybody's doing their absolute best, even your daughter, running away from home?
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely. She was doing the best she could do. That was her life. And I was still responsible for her well-being. That was still my role as a parent. And I didn't know really how I was going to achieve that. Or that I did it to her well-being or not. So it was a huge challenge for me in my life. What I can tell you is that we love each other, and that my daughter and I now work together. She's an executive in my company, and just recently she told me that she wanted to move to New York, and I support her completely in that desire, and whatever it is that she thinks is going to fulfill her life. And I'm very unhappy on one level that she's not going to be here, that I won't have her available. And, you know, I decide to call her and go drive and visit with her or have breakfast or share some time if she does move to New York. And I accept that that's her life and her choice.
Out of birth before we
close. Yes.
Where does acceptance stop? With regard to your daughter, at some point you wouldn't accept what she's doing to herself and eventually you brought to it. You're a very creative individual. To me, creativity means change. At what point don't you accept some figures you see in a movie, for instance, a producing or in your business, that things aren't going right with you? You don't accept.
Well, I strived earlier to talk about how accepting the moment in reality, what actually is different than an intention to have something else occur in the future. So there are a lot of things that I intend to transform, to change. And for me to have any efficacy, any ability to actually do them, I first have to accept that that's what is in the moment. And you've heard people say, well, I can't believe it. How could that be? I can't believe it. Well, if you can't believe it, if you don't accept it, well, then how are you going to do anything about it? So first, I accept what is. And then I strive and intend for something else to emerge in the future. and I apply my will to it and my energy by declaring a new possibility. Out of every failure in the moment, I first have to accept that failure. I have to accept that something is not working. And see it for what it is. And then I can have the ability to create a new possibility of what I can create. Does that answer the question? So acceptance for me does not mean acquiescence or surrender. So thank you for the question, because I get that I didn't make the distinction clear enough. Acceptance has not the meaning for me of surrender, giving in, believing that nothing else is possible. None of that is part of acceptance for me. Acceptance is getting that that's what's happening right now, the way it is, and getting that that is the moment.
So acceptance is more a fact of seeing.
Seeing and not resisting seeing. I mean, if I don't completely accept the moment, if I resist it in some way, that is, I don't hear it all, I don't see it all, I don't feel it all, I'm not there completely in whatever it is that's not working. I have discovered that I'm ill-equipped to transform it because I'm in denial.
And if there's a disruptive force or someone that's creating havoc, then something that needs to be addressed, you can accept things, but you can also confront people in situations, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yes, I take action.
Be tough on people.
Yes. Absolutely. However, if I don't accept exactly what's happening, how can I even have a hope of doing anything constructive about it? Yes.
Thank you. Your peacefulness feels like it's penetrated the whole room, which is really nice. You could be teaching classes in mindful awareness. What I can't figure out is, what is your typical day after the green breakfast like that you can answer 100 emails per day? I'm just in awe. What is your day like? Where do you find that kind of time? And I appreciate your saying, you want people to know that you're there with and for them, so that's why you want them answered. I don't really have that intent, I just don't make it.
The ability to be in the moment gives me a tremendous amount of time in the day. When I'm not in the moment, when I just notice that I'm not in the moment, it's because I daydreamed and went somewhere else. And that happens. And as soon as I notice that I'm daydreaming, then I come back to the moment. And the discipline of listening to myself and my thoughts brings me back to the moment very quickly. And that's what allows me to be efficient with my time. By doing that, time becomes elastic. Yes.
This acceptance of, and your discipline of living in the moment, do you think that's a byproduct of you living your life successfully? Or it was a guideline to living your life successfully?
No, it was a guideline. This is certainly something that I credit the teachers in my life the examples of the people who I have studied with and my application to those lessons that were given to me. So this is something I've learned. As a young man, I lived my life out of rage. At the age of 18 years old, I was indicted by the grand jury of Los Angeles and I was facing life in jail. At the age of 19, I was indicted a second time and the district attorney decided to hold me without bail. And the ACLU had to come in and make motion saying that I was indicted to bail. I lived my life completely out of rage and adrenaline. I remember that person. And I'm not that person. It's because of the lessons and discipline that I was able to be who I am now.
Yes. I actually just answered. I was going to ask you what the defining moments, if those were the two defining moments that propelled you to start living the moment. I know you mentioned, I think, Fernando Robles.
Fernando Flores. Actually not. It's very romantic and glorious to go down as a martyr in a righteous struggle for social justice. It's intoxicating. No, I didn't learn a whole lot of lessons during that period. No, it was when I started my first business and had the intention of being successful, of making movies, and found myself self-sabotaging continually, of defeating myself, of blowing up relationships, of having success and clutching that success and throwing it into the jaws of failure and defeat. And it was Fernando who I went to as a business coach. And it was my listening to him and discovering that it was my belief system that was causing me to self-sabotage. The belief system came out of a whole series of cultural sayings that I grew up with that had to do with money being evil, of not looking to be better than the people in my neighborhood or family, of believing that you know, it's more likely to get into what's the saying? The more likely for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than a rich man to go to heaven. So all these beliefs that I had about money and success, that they were betrayals of my community, were causing me to behave in a way that destroyed my possibility of success. And so, again, that came from listening to myself, observing what the thought processes were, that I was able to see that that's what was driving me. That these unexamined beliefs, cultural beliefs that I grew up with as a Chicano in East LA, where if you, in the 50s, carried books, you were agarachado. You were trying to be white. If you studied and got good grades, you were rejected. You thought people would say, pues, te crees que eres mejor que yo. You think that you're better than I. And all of these sayings, all of these behaviors, were really coming out of hundreds of years of oppression, psychological and military, historical oppression, that creates a culture of victimhood and of poverty. And it was examining and listening to all those beliefs that then allowed me to identify how those beliefs were controlling my behavior and leading me into sabotaging my own success. And by success, also my ability to achieve the goals that I have. So by actually noticing those beliefs, they lost power. As I listened and observed the beliefs that were running me, that I was unaware of, they melted. Like passing a magnet over an incredibly powerful computer program, and it vanishes.
Do you think in some way, when you were obviously experiences make the person, and the experiences that you had when you were young,
clear on your question.
For example, I don't know about you, my friend invited me, so I heard it was a lockout, and it was a political, one of the, the schools were not having enough funds for education, or the Latino community, but and you acted upon that. There was a struggle there, and people did not want to accept that, and that's why they had to walk out or make initiate an action. So what I'm asking is, those people obviously at some point say, well, this is what's happening right now. You accept what's happening, but you can make an action upon it. Does that make you a good person? You look back on it and say, well, you know what, I went through that experience.
Well, each experience is its own experience. My experiences make me who I am. They don't make me a better person over someone else. Now, my response to what was going on in the 50s and the 60s in terms of education came out of, again, yes, the people that trained me and that educated me. My father continually talked about the social inequities in Mexico. And the icons that he raised me looking to were Pancho Villa and Francisco Madero and Emiliano Zapata and Che Guevara and Fidel Castro. And so that's what he talked to me about. And when he grew up in Mexico, it was a time of revolution. He was born in 1900. So he was 18 years old and came to the United States. It was towards the end of the Mexican Revolution, but it wasn't over. And so that's what he gave to me. He was part of the group that was around Flores Magón. Flores Magón was one of the architects of the Mexican Revolution. And he was an exile here in Southern California. And my father was part of that group. So that is my inheritance from a political point. And that inheritance is still who I am today. I continue to be an activist. I continue to be engaged in social protest and in the seeking of transforming a society. That's the only thing that I can tell you that's different from when I was 18 is that then I was destroying myself and I was living in rage and I was incredibly unhappy. And today, I can see a role for myself where I can continue to work at creating the possibility of the promise of this country and also have my own life.
Did Fernando Flores, did he also coach you on, you know, as you decided that you could live your life in a way that was, you know, divergent from all the messaging you received? You know, there's that one issue that people resist change from a, let's say, a self-actualization standpoint is, you know, that it might make people that are more kind of not, and they're stuck in their ways, it might make them uncomfortable. It might make family members uncomfortable, or old friends that you grew up with uncomfortable, or at least perceived that way, as you sort of have a, you know, your more evolved approach. Did you struggle with that, and did you get any coaching on that subject of not feeling, being able to accept that?
Well,
having, you know, moving on from friendships even?
I was just reflecting on your use of the word evolved. I don't know that I'm more evolved. You know, what I'm getting now is that people are fine. You know, people are fine the way they are in terms of who they are. Now I'm not talking about social conditions or politics, but in terms of my family and my friends. I get to have a relationship with them now that is based on me accepting who they are. Yes.
You mentioned earlier that you are a social activist and you continue to be one. And I was interested to hear what types of social issues you're concerning yourself with now. What are the possibilities that you see for those issues, the challenges and the possibilities?
Well, my career has been focused on media. And when I chose to be a producer, I made a declaration that I would commit myself to the transformance of the image of Latinos in Hollywood and through Hollywood the world, with the aim of creating human images, three-dimensional images. And that led me to accept the goal of creating images of humans and of looking at what it is to be human in the movies that I created and the work that I do. So that informs my work, and that is in fact what I've devoted myself to, and that's an expression of the social activism the transforming of Hollywood. So creating a movie studio so that I can make the movies that I choose to make, and building theaters so I can exhibit the movies that I wish to exhibit, is an expression of that. And it is an expression that also to create wealth. So the areas in which I devote myself, media, education, I founded a charter school called the Los Angeles Academy of Arts and Enterprise that empowers young people to be artists and to be business people, and that blows up the idea that artists have to start. I founded and chairman of many organizations. The National Latino Independent Producers Association, which I helped found 11 years ago. The Numeric Alliance, which is a business organization, which has as its principles creating wealth in our community, promoting human capital, promoting strategic philanthropy, promoting